Good morning and welcome to Heritage Baptist Church. If you will stand and sing with me, number 285.
Thank you for allowing us to come into your house today, Lord. And Lord, we want to thank you for this beautiful day and for this country, Lord. And Lord, just be with our military and our soldiers, Lord. Protect them wherever they may be. And be with the policemen. And Lord, just be with the pastor and all the leaders of the church. And Lord, we want to thank you for being a savior for us. That we can lean on you anytime that we're in trouble, and we can ask you to help us each step of the way. Thank you for this day, Lord. I ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
It is good to be here today. Thank you for all your prayers, and I know you are praying for others as well as the pastor today, and it's good to be here. We are grateful to God for his blessings. Aren't you glad that God is who he is?
Amen.
He's such a magnificent God. He identifies with us all some way other than just that he's our savior. You know, if you're easygoing, lovable kind, you know, he's that kind of savior too. Amen. If you're a warrior, he is one of those too. And if you, the scripture says we have the ability in the world to become all things to all men, that by any means we might save some. That's what Paul said he was praying for. That's not easy to do because it's not as easy for us. But God became us. You know what the scripture says? He came in the world, lived as a human, did all these wonderful things. Lord, and we see all that in our Lord, and we're grateful. But you know, in our people around us, we see that too. And we are privileged to be able to live in the United States of America. And we are privileged to be and have and participate and enjoy the freedoms that we have. Excluding the founding fathers, with very few exceptions of politicians. Okay? But every freedom we have, everything we enjoy, some military person earned that for us. For all you veterans that are out there, do you think sometimes that you're underappreciated? You're not. I don't care if you ran a typewriter in the military, or if you ran a 50 cal machine gun. If you walked the jungles, or if you walked the deserts, or if you worked on a ship, you're part of what keeps our country free. And we thank you today. This is the time of year we remember our veterans and thank God for each one of them. Some people serve those, you know, they called the Minutemen? They called them part-time soldiers or citizen soldiers. Well, those citizen soldiers outnumbered the real army. So they played big parts, and we're grateful for that. You might have served in the National Guard. God bless you. I met a lot of National Guard people in some place beside America when they were called up and gone. Thank you for that service, and thank you for the lifetime some of your retired military. God bless your hearts. I pray that God blesses you greatly. And I understand that most people in the world don't quite understand that, but if you're military, you do. And if whether you had a great experience in the military or you had a terrible experience, or maybe you was that terrible experience in the military, I don't know. But either way, thank you for your service. Thank you for doing what you did for the time and the part of your life that you put in it. And so, of course, most of you know I have lots of my family is military people and always have been, and we have a lot invested in our country. And so far, this, as far as I can remember, there was somebody, I think I had relatives on both sides of the Civil War. But as far as I know, none of my family even died in that. None of them died in World War I, and none of my family died in World War II, and a lot of them served. And they all came back from Vietnam, and they came through Korea, and isn't that amazing? And you say, well, you know, and part of you can't say that. You lost people there, and when Memorial Day comes around, you have somebody to put on your flag and put on your window, and you have that gold star in the window, don't you? Thank you for being who you are. We love the Lord Jesus because he first loved us. And the Bible says, and I think he's talking a lot, some about Christians, but a lot about soldiers. Greater love hath no man than this, and a man lay down his life for his friends. It's an amazing thing. We want to remind you today that God's good. Amen. Even when the world doesn't think so, God's good. And even when you can't see him, God's good. And even when I don't think so, God's good. And you say, you ever have those days? Well, you know me, I never. That would be a lie. Sure I do. I'm wondering, God, where are you at? You ever read what David's saying sometimes? Lord, have you forgotten me? Are you still out there? Am I wandering around on my own? Read the Psalms. He had quite a few of those days out there. And I'm sure if you know the Lord Jesus, you understood that he went so many trials that he would talk to the Father about the same thing. One of the great things about being Christian is that the retirement is out of the world. Amen. Think about that. I finally got a smile out of a couple. Part of you are still asleep. You got an extra hour, and now you're still grumpy. Okay, come on, get over it. And if you're watching today, the preacher's trying to smile, but we used to have a lady, I come from a long line of frowning Indians. Okay? And I preached one time in an Indian church, and they just stare at you when you're preaching. Sort of like y'all do when I'm preaching, you know. You're not sure if I had a friend in high school who could sleep with his eyes open. You guys remind me of Rusty, you know. But got through the service and I said, you know, what's the matter? Didn't you guys like the preaching at all? One of them said, you know, preacher, it's hard to say. I said, why don't you guys say amen or something once in a while? And he goes, it's hard to say sick until the dog has got you by the leg, you know. So I think he explained it really well. What do y'all think? Amen. We're glad that you're with us today. Remember that we have some special things going on. If you look in your bulletin, of course, you realize we're almost halfway in through the month of November already?
Yeah.
Wow. Who's stealing our year away, right? Our anniversary service is on the 21st. We'll celebrate. This will be our 30th year, right? Is that right? This is the one. 91 to 2021. No, this is our 30th year in November. We came here in 91. You like that? At least I think it is. We moved here in December of 1991. So, no. Yeah, I was right. 91. And now you've got me worried about it. So, and that's right. And I know this. Next week, I'll be celebrating my 57th anniversary, right? No? Oh, yeah, it's 48. Amen. It only seems like eight. It's so wonderful. It seems like 8 years. But anyhow, we were both 12 when we got married. And so we're working on there. Amen. That's not true either. But we're glad to have you here with us. We'll celebrate our anniversary this year and how God goes through this thing. And what a miracle. And you don't understand. You know how you realize how much God's blessed you? I'm serious. We figured that out this last week or two, haven't we? Talking to Jana, of course. She's my secretary. You get your insurance renewed, and you have people walking through and going, ooh, that costs $40,000. That'll raise your premium. Ooh, that costs $20,000. It'll raise your premium. That'll be... You can get through and goes, I didn't know we owned so much. Amen? So, you sure? Am I telling the truth? It just gets... I just thought it was... You know what I mean? You want to see... Y'all are still looking at me like... Well, I'm just checking to see if there's something back there y'all are staring at, okay? Call your insurance agent. Tell them to come out and walk through the house and tell you what you got that's valuable. You need to get reinsured. They'll find almost everything. They'll walk out and you go, wow, we're richer than I thought. Isn't it good? Now you can laugh. Ha, ha, ha. Okay, here we go. All you people out there online, it's the same way every week. So here we go. Get it together. Thanksgiving thing. Communion week. We're going to have Tuesday night services, do communion. No Wednesday night service and regular Thanksgiving Day. Of course, Thanksgiving Day is on Thursday this year. Christmas is going to be here pretty quick. We're working on three pretty good-sized projects. We want you to help us. Events like for Operation Christmas Child have to be in this week. Done. Make sure you got them done. We're pretty close to that. And I don't know that anybody that hasn't got most of their stuff together or at least has it ready to turn in. But we also are going to do things for the Navajo Nation. And anything that you can bring, they're not on Operation Christmas Child. You couldn't bring liquids like shampoo or soaps or things like that. But in the Navajo Nation, you can. And we're also doing special things for Christmas. You know, I don't know. You know, we support year round. We support the Homeless No More Project. Now, I don't know. How many of you already know what you're buying your wife or husband for Christmas? Ooh, that's sad. Nobody. No, one hand went up. How many of you who are here today expect to get a gift for Christmas? One hand. Amen. All right. That's even sadder, right? So now you know how the homeless people feel, right? How many things? You say, well, preacher, no, we help them with this, and we are with that, and we're doing with that. And good. I'm glad. How many of you think you're going to get a Christmas present? Come on. Yeah. He thinks he's going to get one. I talked to his wife and she said no. Okay. She said something about buying you a burial plot 5 years ago and you ain't used it yet. So she's not going to buy anything for you. That's right. So anyhow, I want you to know that, guys, here's an opportunity for you. Maybe just pick out some man thing, besides just like the toothpaste, toothbrush, shampoo, things like that that you donate for it. Put something in a box. Now, I grew up real poor. And if I told you, it sounds like I'm lying, but I ain't. You know what I mean? But I joked with my wife and I said, you know, in the fifth grade, my teacher said, her name was Miss Inman. She said, George, if you had 25 cents in one pocket and 35 cents in the other pocket, what would you have? And I said, somebody else's pants, you know, because we didn't have any change. I'm telling you right now, guys, it was a big deal. Listen to me. I know people do all kinds of things, but this has been, October was pastor or what they call it, clergy appreciation month. And every time one of you gave me a card or just said thank you, it meant a lot to me. And I mean that. I can't imagine it wouldn't for them. Think about that. Just make it maybe a small men's gift or I don't know what you'd get them. God will put that on your heart. And I promise you that if he's the God, I know it'll turn out okay. You can do that. But help us out in that. Share some of the blessings. Jesus said it. In the verse, by the way, Jesus, we don't have it recorded in the Gospels. You know who said it? Apostle Paul learned it from Jesus in the desert. He said, Jesus said, it's better to give than to receive. And it's written in red in one of his epistles. Because that's what the Lord said. Let's think about that. Christmas time, find a way to be a blessing to somebody else. got that going. Then we have services tonight. Looking forward to you being here with us. And I'm excited about preaching what I'm preaching. I'm going to finish up that lesson about Saul and the witch at Endor this evening. I think you'll learn something if you'll come. Right now, we're going to have a word of prayer and ask God to bless all of our missionaries. At Christmas time is a hard time to be away from home. How many of you veterans were away from home at a Christmas? You spent a Christmas away from home. Yeah? Okay. And you're some other foreign, ungodly country or Oklahoma or somewhere, you know, somewhere. But anyhow, you were someplace else. And even guys, listen to me. You can remember that. There's nothing like being home at Christmas, is there? And nothing like being around the family you love, and that's a wonderful time. A lot of our missionaries won't be here. They'll be on their fields doing what God called them to do, serving their folks. Why don't you remember to pray for them and ask God's grace in that? A lot of them are still going through tremendous, and I'm talking about Australia and New Zealand, because they have like 2 hours. In some parts of Australia and New Zealand, but 2 hours, one time a week, they can get out of the house. They have to get a passport card to go to the grocery store, and they either use it that 2 hours or you're done. Now, that's one thing to be in a foreign country. It's another to be almost like a prisoner. So a lot of them, they're doing the best they can. They're doing internet stuff. They're putting out all kinds of things, and they're working hard. A lot of them are here in America, frustrated. And my fear is that they're going to get frustrated enough that they won't go back to the field if they open up. And you need to pray about that. So join with me today. We're going to pray for our missionaries, especially this morning. Our Father in heaven, what a privilege it is to be a God. I understand that I have the greatest God of all time, merciful, kind, outstanding in every way. But Lord, it's a greater privilege to be a child of God. And Lord, to serve you. And Lord, I chose you because you first chose me. It was your offering. It was your love. It was your call. I just responded to it. And I did that, Lord, because some home missionary went to where you called him to. And he stayed when it was hard. And he was there when I walked in and heard the gospel for the first time. Lord, I pray you bless our missions program. I understand how frustrating it must be for them. And I understand, Lord, that when we're called to do something, we feel like that's what we should be doing, and yet restrictions sometimes prohibit that. I'm asking you first, Lord, that you'd comfort their hearts and let them know, Lord, we understand the best we know how, that they're doing what they can do. We ask you second, Lord, to just give them great ideas about ways they can use the same situation the world around to bring the gospel to the hearts of men and women. I don't care how they do it. I'm not even going to try to mention all the ways. I just pray for encouragement for them. And then, Lord, I want them to know every month when they get a support check from us that there's somebody back here not only just thinking about them, but is actually holding them up in prayer before the throne of God. And Lord, may they be blessed and encouraged and revitalized. And Lord, with a new vision that no matter what, they're going to do it. Lord, I pray for that. I pray for our people. I thank you, Lord, for their open-heartedness. Lord, they're such good givers. They're such good people as far as supporting the things, caring about others. And Lord, I ask that you'd help us to do more. Time is short. The world is getting darker. Help us, Lord, to be that light. And Lord, thank you for the lights that you sent out through us in our missions program. And we ask you to bless each one today in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
264.
Tis the grandest thing.
Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom we all hold dear, now is at stake. Humbling your heart to God, safe from the chastening rod. Seek the way pilgrims trod, Christians awake. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom. Trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise. Righteous meet in the sky. Going where no one dies. Heavenward bound. Troublesome times are here. Happy forevermore. When we meet on that shore. Free from all care. Rising up in the sky, telling this world goodbye. Homeward we then will fly, glory to share. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom. Trumpets will surely sound. All of the dead shall rise. Righteous meet in the skies. Going where no one dies. Homeward we're bound. Jesus is coming soon. Morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom. Trumpets will surely sound. All of the dead shall rise. Righteous meet in the skies. Going where no one dies. Heavenward bound. Going where no one dies. Heavenward bound. Heavenward bound.
Very good. There you go. Amen. It's good, wasn't it? Enjoyed that song. I've been wanting to sing that with a quartet for about 6 or 8 months. And they said, no. Well, I couldn't sing this week. And they said, let's sing that song. And so they did. I sang with you guys. All right. I'm just sitting down there. And you say, what part do you sing? I sing every part. Okay. Because every one of them said, hey, you're running on my part. Anytime we're singing a song, I've heard one of them say that. So we work at that. We're glad to have you with us. Look with me in the book of 1 Kings, chapter 18, verse 27. Somebody, before you turn there, tell me what the chapter's about. Chapter 18, famous chapter. Everybody ought to know this chapter. 1 Kings 18. It's one of those things. Chapter 18, 1 Kings, what's about? It's about Elijah and the prophets of Baal. Remember that story? I want you to look there with me, because I'm going to talk to you about the wonder of the ninth hour today. And I'm going to teach you something, preach to you something, and I hope encourage your heart just a little bit. Now, most of the time we're thinking about stuff. We know what it means when you say, you know, the thief on the cross was he was saved at 11 o'clock, you know, or the 12th hour. And we mean that, we know that means the end, right? Because it's not, you know, the last minute. You know, that's not very good odds, that 50-50, only one of them got saved. And so if I was you and I was lost, I wouldn't say, I'm going to wait. I don't want to be. If your surgeon told you tomorrow, you know, we're going to do surgery on you, and there's a 50% chance you're going to come out of it, you would say, woohoo, 50%, right? No, you'd be called a preacher and you'd go, hey, so let's double the 50%, but we're going to you interpreted that. That's what it sounds like when you're saying 50% and you're trying to cry at the same time. Nobody likes 50% chance. You know the Lord or Savior, there's not a chance that you will stay saved or be saved. You are saved. You're done, okay? There's no odds to it. You say, well, you know, you say, well, what do you think the odds are you're going to get to go to heaven? Well, Jesus said it was 100%. If I would not, weren't so, he said he had to tell me. And I want you to know, this whole Israel thing was a puzzle. Simply because they could not set their heart on what God told them and believe it, they wandered like a drunk guy driving on a 4-lane highway at nighttime from one side to the other, bouncing off the bumpers of life and all the obstacles through it. They grabbed a hold of anything that seemed it would be a little bit better on the way through, all kinds of foolish religions. They allowed them to come in. And I know these are the 10 northern tribes, and they left under Jeroboam in Solomon's son's reign, okay? But God told him if he lived for the Lord, he did the right thing, that he would continue him as well. But he didn't. He was afraid that the people would go back to God. Isn't that scary? If they went back to God, then they would leave him. So he led them in the path of worshiping false gods. And he started out with the 3 golden calves that he made, and they worshiped those things. And finally it went down. By the time you get Ahab, who is king of Israel, he's married to Jezebel, who is the high princess of the Baal worshipers. Okay? These are wicked people. They're wicked people. They taught Israel how to offer their live babies alive in a fire. They're wicked people. And some have commented that, and you don't want to talk about that much, but Israel was taught they had to eat their sacrifices. And it was part of that when you see that God would see these people following that. And so God took a great stand, and Elijah puts his life on the line, goes to Ahab, say either straighten it up or it's not going to rain for 3.5 years, and it doesn't. And he puts his life on the line, and a lot of other things happen. And at the end of this time, he gathers as many people who will come from Israel up on Mount Carmel, and he has them ask them a choice. You'll see that choice in verse 24 when it says, and he's talking to all the 450 priests of Baal and the 450 servants of Baal, which is about 800 or 900 of them there. And he says this, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take 2 bullocks. You choose one of them. Or we would call them bulls, okay? And you choose the one you want. I'll take the other one. You're going to go first. You build an altar, you put wood on it, you put the sacrifice on it, and you call on Baal. And when you're done, I'll do the same for mine. And the God who answers by fire from heaven will be God. Look at the last line of chapter 24, chapter number 18, verse 24. And all the people answered, "It is well spoken. Whoever answers by fire will be our God." Right? And Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, "Choose you one bullock for yourselves and dress it first, and for your many, call on the name of your God, but not put no fire under it." And they took the bullock which they had given, they dressed it, called on the name of Baal from the morning until noon, saying, "O Baal, hear us," but there was no voice, nor any that answered. They leaped upon the altar which is made. It came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked him. There's something about Elijah I just like. You know that? And he said, "Cry aloud, for he is a God. Either he's talking, or he's pursuing, or he's gone on a journey. Preferentially, he sleeps, and you got to wake him up, you know." They're ready to offer Elijah on the altar, I promise you. And they cried aloud. They cut themselves after their manner with their knives and lances. Still blood gushed upon them. And they came to pass when midday was past, that's noon, until the time of the evening sacrifice, that there was neither voice nor any to answer, nor anything that regarded. And this really quick, I'll show you in a minute, but every day in Israel, it started out with a sacrifice. Most people, especially Gentile Christians, believe that once a year they took one lamb and they offered it for a Passover. That was true in the corporate sense. But in the everyday sense, you had thousands of priests working every day, offering thousands of sacrifices. There were several million people in Israel. Every time they sinned the sin, they had to bring an offering and offer it to get right with God. On top of that, every day, at the third hour, which would be 9 o'clock, started at 6. I'm going to show it to you so you can see it in a little bit. At 9 o'clock, they offered a lamb. I'll show you the verse in a minute about it too. And then through the day, they offered those people's sacrifices and did all that. But they started with that lamb. At 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, all those hours in between, they offered those daily sacrifices that people brought. Remember when Jesus was born, they came in to have him circumcised. They had to bring, if they were rich enough, they would bring a lamb. If they weren't, they brought turtle doves or whatever they could. But they had to offer those as a sacrifice. So the priests were continually working constantly. And so much so that they only worked 1 month. They have 12 courses of priests, and they would rotate around every month. They'd just wear them out. They couldn't do that every day for 12 months. So they came down 30 days and went off. Go back to the book of Luke, and you'll find that when John the Baptist's dad was in there, he said he was in there in the order of his course. Right? He was taking his turn. Now, at 3 o'clock, all that other stuff stopped because they offered the second lamb for all of Israel. These are the daily ones, guys, not the once a year. They offered the second lamb at 3 o'clock, which is the ninth hour. The day starts at 6. Watch, count with me. Watch my hand. 6. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 3. 3 o'clock. You'll find over and over and over and over again in the scriptures. It mentions the morning sacrifice and the evening sacrifice. He had them start and adhere to a rule that Israel would have done. They started early in the morning, and they went 3 hours, and at noon, nothing had happened. So they've been out there working this whole time, okay? At noon, he starts making fun of them. And he makes fun of them until the scripture says this. Verse 29, came to pass when midday was past, and they prophesied until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, 3 o'clock, the ninth hour. There was neither voice nor any answer. And Elijah said unto the people, come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench round about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed, several bushels. And he put the wood in the order and cut the bullock in pieces and laid him on the wood and said, fill the 4 barrels with water. They went down to the brook Kidron, came back bringing 4 barrels, poured it on it. He said, do it a second time. So they came back. They soaked the sacrifice. They soaked the rocks. They soaked the wood. They soaked all the seed and everything else with water standing in it. Verse 35, the water ran about the altar and filled the trench also with water. He did that to prove there wasn't any fire in there. You understand that? This is no trick. It came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Jacob, let it be known that this day that thou art God in Israel. Now you remember that. He said, let it be known that you are God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and I have done all thy things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell. Now, look at this. This is cool. I like it. Consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up all the water that was in the trench. And the people said, show us that again, we might believe it. Now, look at verse 39. When all the people saw it, they fell on their faces. They said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. I believe it. He's God. God just proved to them who he was. And he did it at the 9th hour. Isn't that cool? The Jews divided the day up into 2 halves. The night half. Now, this is hard for us as Gentiles, okay? And the reason that most of the people I know can never get Easter figured out or the resurrection day figured out is because they want to do what Gentiles do. They want to say, in the morning and then the evening. And go back to Genesis, will you, when you look at that, and look what the scripture says. It says, in the evening and the morning were the first day. If you went to Israel today with me, their Sabbath would start at 6 p.m. our Friday. When you figure that God never quit telling time that way, and neither did the Jews, it's not hard to figure out Jesus was crucified when, and that he would rise again on the first day of the week, their time. Now, somebody asked me the other day, said, preacher, you know, do you know when Jesus is coming? I said, well, I say he's going to come at 3 o'clock. They said, well, Jesus said nobody would know the day nor the hour or the times of the season. I'm telling you, he's going to come at 3 o'clock. He said, would you get that out of the Bible? No, I got it from Jimmy Buffett. Jimmy Buffett said it's 5 o'clock somewhere. Amen. Amen. Come on now, look at me. It's going to be 3 o'clock somewhere when he comes, right? So y'all can laugh a little bit, see? There you go. Most of you guys get your theology from a lot of songs. Go, come on, pick it up. I got mine from Jimmy Buffett. He's talking about drinking. I'm thinking about Jesus coming. It'll be 3 o'clock somewhere in the world, or at least the 3rd hour when Jesus comes. It may not be where I'm at. It may be somewhere else. I guarantee you, whatever hour it is, it'll be according what it is in Israel. It won't have anything to do with the rest of the world. But I want you to think with me real quick about this. The 3rd hour, the morning sacrifice, and then the 9th hour, the evening sacrifice, were extremely important times in every day. The night began at 6 p.m., ended at 6. The day half was 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And the morning and the evening were the first day. 6 a.m. was the 1st hour. Noon was the 6th hour. 3 p.m. was the 9th hour. 6 p.m. was the 12th hour. All through your Bible, you'll see that. And when you get to the book of Mark, he starts writing to Gentile people instead of to Jews, and he does it like the Romans do. First watch, second watch, third watch, fourth watch, because they divided their watches up into 3-hour breaks. And so it was still 3 hours time, but it was first, second, third, or fourth watch. That's what Mark says, because he's talking to, they wouldn't understand the first hour, third hour thing, because they were Gentiles and they started their day at sunrise. He was talking to the Gentiles. God's talking to us, and he's talking to his people who knew exactly what time it was and what part of the day it was and what that hour meant. And all those people of Israel, when they saw that fire fall down at the ninth hour, taking that sacrifice up, they understood that was what pleased God. So it scared them to death. I've never been around a fire that consumed the rocks. They said, I think we're going to go with God on this one. Amen. It was the sixth hour. 6 a.m. was the first hour. Look through it. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Evening first. And they still keep their time that way. You remember that in your Bible. You say, well, you know, I don't believe that God particularly likes anybody better than anybody else. And you should be grateful to live in the age of grace, but I'm going to tell you something, whether you like it or not, and I want God to know that I know it, that he chose the Jewish people, and he caused great suffering through their lifetime, and he brought a lot of things into the life. He brought blessings, and he brought great tragedies, and he made a covenant with them where millions of them died because they wouldn't keep it for one purpose, and that was to bring us a Savior into the world. One more thing. The scripture says the oracles of God came through the Jew. As far as I can tell, there's not one Gentile written book. He said, well, I heard that you did. You heard that? What? That Mark wasn't or Luke wasn't? Now, you can prove that from your Bible, right? Guys, I went to Bible college, too. I was under all those professors who taught that stuff. I had one answer. I said, show me where it says that anywhere in the scripture. Well, you know, according to the church father in the fourth, he's in the fourth century. How did he know who Mark was? I'm going to go with Jesus on everything, okay? And he went out about the third hour and saw others standing. Remember that? That parable of the guy that has the vineyard? He goes out about the third hour. What time is it? What time is it at 3 o'clock? Okay, look. 6. 9 o'clock. Good. And these are not drunken as you suppose. Paul or Peter's preaching to them on the day of Pentecost. And he says, seeing is but the third hour of the day. What time is it? 9 o'clock. Guess what? Guess what happened on that day? God sent the Holy Spirit into the world during that 1 hour. You know why? Because he proved to us at that hour by the coming of the Holy Spirit who he was. Every day Israel offered a lamb because this is who God is. That third hour is important. And he called unto him 2 centurions saying, make ready. Go to Caesarea and horsemen 70, spearmen about 200 at the third hour of the night. Now see, it's 9 o'clock at night. Right? So they divided the day and the night up the same. It was according to the morning and the evening sacrifice. There's a second way they recognized time, and that was the morning and evening sacrifice. You hear about the time of the morning sacrifice, about the time of the evening sacrifice. If you look at this, go through it. In Exodus chapter number 29 and verse 39, he said, the one lamb that shall offer in the morning, and the other lamb shall offer at evening. One at 9 o'clock in the morning, and one at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Every day, just like clockwork. Just like clockwork. The morning sacrifice was the third hour. The evening sacrifice was the ninth hour. Look at verse 29 and 36 of the verse. And I'm just going to read verse 36 on it. He said, came to pass at the same time of day at the evening sacrifice. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, God proved who he was. God proved who he was. The ninth hour was also the time to pray. Now, twice a day, Israel stopped and prayed. And they prayed at these 2 hours. They did because they knew that somewhere, wherever that temple was or wherever they were, somewhere somebody was offering a lamb, and they stopped at that time, no matter where they were, and they prayed to the God of heaven. Yea, while I was speaking in prayer, at the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fire swiftly, touched me at the time of the evening oblation. Peter's up on a rooftop, and he's praying. Daniel's somewhere in Babylon, and he's praying. All at the same time. Not to say, they're about 1,000 years apart, but, you know, it's the same hour of the day. And he informed me and talked with me and said, oh, Daniel, I'll come forth to give thee the skill and understanding. Guess when he came? Came at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Look at Peter. Peter and John went up together at the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. You know when the first Gentile was saved? You know when the first Gentile got saved recorded in the Bible? You know when it was? There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band, a devout man, one that feared God with all of his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God. And he saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour, about 3 in the afternoon, the prayer time, the offering time, an angel of God coming to him and saying unto him, Cornelius. Now, listen to me. Cornelius had said, God had told him, said, go get Peter. Send down to Joppa. He's down there with Simon the Tanner. I got a picture of that house still standing there at Joppa. It's got a sign on it, so it has to be the same one, right? It's right there on the... Your tanners need a lot of water, so they're right there by the seashore. And he gets in Peter's praying... One at the same time, Cornelius is praying, the scripture says, and he's on top of the house. And God tells Peter something in a minute I'm going to show you. But Cornelius said to him when he got there, he said, 4 days ago I was fasting in this hour. At the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and behold, stood before me a man in bright clothing. He said, Cornelius, thy prayer is heard. I want you to think about this, guys. God is going to do something that... very few Jews, and Jesus said it. Isaiah prophesied of it. Most of the Old Testament told us it was coming. But even Saul, the great apostle Paul-to-be, could hardly accept it. That Gentiles were going to be saved. Now, we don't mind if a Jewish crook gets saved on the Saul, on the cross, but not them wretched Gentile people. Gives you the shivers, doesn't it? We're going to have to live in heaven with them. God had a plan. And the plan included the world. Israel never did see that he was using them in the plan to bring it to the world. That was their job. And they did it. Somehow or another, did you ever meet somebody that explained to you the real facts of life? You know, that's what Elijah did when the fire came down from heaven and the people said, I think I just decided, right? Sometimes you have to be forced. And I actually had a guy tell me one time, he said, I can't make you do anything, but I'll make you wish you had. You know, I believe that guy. And I tried to do everything he told me to do. You know, we have a God in heaven, if he wanted to, could force you to do. But he will never make you make a decision except on your own. He wants you. But I promise you there'll be a day coming when you wish you had. I'm grateful for my decision in Christ. I don't want to turn back. Christian life is a wonderful life, but it's not always the easy life. But I can tell you something, the same God that was in charge of these times is still the same God who's in charge of every little tiny detail in my life and yours. While he's dealing with Peter, and Peter's thinking, what is he doing? He's dealing with a Gentile man way in another place about the same issue. See, our God can do all that. 4 days ago, I was fasting. In the ninth hour, I prayed. He said, Peter said it. Thy prayer is heard. The angel said it, And that your alms have been had in remembrance of the sight of God. When Elijah prayed, God proved himself. No doubt about it. The God from heaven sent down fire, burnt up everything. Now, verse 39, you should write that somewhere in your memoirs. The Lord, He is God. Do you know what? Do you know when Jesus died? Let me show you something that's really particular about these third hour, ninth hour things, you know? They took him out to the cross. And the Bible says if they put him on that cross, and it was the third hour, you think that was just happened? It didn't. God had a plan. At the time of the morning sacrifice, He has him put up on the cross. The scripture says, the next 3 hours he hung there. And all the world around him mocking him and calling him names. And he endured all that, along with the terror of the cross and the beating and all that went with it. And about the sixth hour, which would be noon, all of a sudden God quietens the crowd down. Just like Elijah. He quietened them down. They're over there making all that hollering and screaming. About noon, he says, it's time for you guys to quit. Calm down. God, the Bible says, in the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. Can you imagine being there? And all of a sudden, it's just pitch black dark. You've been mocking the man on the cross. He says he's the Son of God. And you're making fun of him. How many think it got deathly silent about then? Because we got a God who can send fire from heaven. And we got a God to take the light out of the sky. Some people think it was the picture of God turning his face away from Jesus, who was made to be sin for us, making it so dark. And about the ninth hour, that 3 o'clock hour, look at this. Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? About the ninth hour, Mark says it again. Got it there. We read it for you. If you look at this, I'm at the end of my sermon. You ever wonder why I'm done already? Because it was at that ninth hour the Lord lifted up his eyes to heaven and he said, it is finished. And every lamb that would offer it at 3, and every lamb that was offered at 9 in the morning, he'd fulfilled every picture type of every offering there ever was. And he could do what they could not do, repeated daily. monthly and annually. And not one time could the blood of bulls and goats take away sin. But this one man hanging there from the morning sacrifice to the evening sacrifice, enduring that, paying the payment for our sin, shedding his own blood, could cry out in terror about being separated from God. And he did it for us. But he didn't leave us hanging there. But he left us with this. It was accomplished. It's finished. At the ninth hour, God is satisfied. God proved who he was, and he proved how much he loved you all at the ninth hour. It's finished. Does that not just grab a hold of your heart? That our God makes every detail and absoluteness. He never left one thing by mistake. Not one thing just happened. Everything was according to the plan of God. Peter would say, he is as the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Now, me and you both know what happened in Elijah's day. Elijah died and Elisha came along, and Elisha died and Israel went right back to their false gods. You know, there are a lot of Christians who never grabbed a hold of what you cost God. And I'm going to tell you something. I don't believe he's in heaven right now thinking about how much we cost him. I think he's in heaven right now, the scripture says, reminding the Father, it's finished. You can bring them home anytime you want. They're paid for. I've been from the third to the ninth hour. And I proved who I was. And I proved how much I loved them. You know, one of these days, I think the Father's going to turn to him and say, why don't you go get them? It's going to be something. How many of you can shiver when you hear that? Whew. Go get them. And I bet it won't take Jesus very long. Just like the fire from heaven. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we'll be gone, won't we? And we have all of that, and we hold on to all of that because of one thing. Our Savior fulfilled every part of the Old Testament law and every requirement of God in our behalf. And he finished it at the ninth hour. Let's bow our heads together. Our Father in heaven, I know that we hear the wonder of the Lord Jesus almost constantly. Sometimes it becomes normal to us. And Lord, I'm going to ask you to do something that, Lord, we have the Spirit of God that deals with our hearts today and remind us how not normal it is for the creature to be so loved by the Creator that he would exchange himself for us. That is not normal. There's no man-made religion. There's no pagan worship. There's nothing in the whole world even comes close to that. That my God would give himself for me. And Lord, I ask you, in my heart, in my mind, in my life, that I never forget that. And over and over and over again, when the devil reminds me of how sinful I am, I can remind them what Jesus said with his last breath. It's finished. It's done. Lord, we look forward to the day to be with you. Until then, Lord, I pray that your grace be part of our life. And there's some here. Lord, they've heard this 50 times, 100 times. And it's never moved their heart. Lord, help them to be saved. To really put their faith and trust in the God that loves them. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand up just a minute, please.
Purpose. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for what a great God you are, Lord. And it's amazing, Lord, to see it in your word, Lord, to hear it preached. What an amazing thing, Lord, that you took care of every detail. You had everything planned. You moved heaven and earth, Lord, to make it go to fruition, Lord. And Lord, it's just amazing to see how much you love us. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for it. Thank you for the great message that we just heard, Lord. And Lord, I pray for my church, guide us and lead us. And I pray all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.